Welcome back to Bayesian Cognitive Modeling. Okay. Ooh. And we're making our way through the case studies here. And if you're new here, this is the tutorial series where, well, not necessarily a tutorial series, but this is the series where I go through and, so this is the series where I go through Bayesian Cognitive Modeling by Michael Lee and Eric Rockenbacher and learn how to conduct Bayesian inference for the cognitive sciences by walking through the chapters and their exercises in a sort of think aloud protocol. And today we're going to be starting chapter 15, which looks like it's the simple model of memory. I've never heard of it, and we're going to go jump right into it today. I'm excited. It's a once again a new chapter. Last chapter was pretty challenging, I'd say, the multinomial processing trees stuff. You know, check it out last episode, but we really got into some of the limitations of the software implementation in JAGS and WinBug specifically, and we had to go over and start implementing some things in Stan, and that certainly took a lot more of our stream time up, just learning some of the basic syntax for Stan and being able to follow along what they were doing. And I think that, you know, there's certainly more work to be done there, but we'll see what happens in the simple chapter and if it's a simple or not, right? But okay, so simple stands for scale invariant memory perception and learning model. Okay, so it looks like it's another free recall thing, which multinomial processing trees were also commonly used for free recall. So that's an interesting theme. Interesting. So the theory, or at least the mathematical representation of the model, is assuming that more temporally distant memories are more similar to one another. Oh, yeah, now we got a different color. Yeah. So uniqueness or distinctiveness is also critical in this theory. So instead of it being that memories decay, it's more that the memories are somehow interfered with in their distinctiveness. And that makes sense. That makes sense because at the initial proposal is that, memories that are farther away are more similar. So if memories that are farther away are more similar, then their distinctiveness is going to decrease, thus creating more interference and making it such that these persons are more likely to forget the concepts. Brown makes some reasonable assumptions about the undocumented aspects of the test. To set T sub I between learning and retrieval of the eighth item. Okay. So there are five stages to the simple model. First, The item is presented at some time point, represented in memory using logarithmic compression. Then, secondly, the similarity between each pair of items is calculated, where C is a parameter measuring distinctiveness. So we have this tuning parameter of C, so things that are less distinct or more distinct. I wonder what is the range of C? Let's see. Go from 1 to 0 to 100. Expectation. So if things were in theory, we'll look at the bounds, 0. The similarity between each item pair when C is 0. So we get some presentation of each of the items, we calculate similarity, we get discriminability. Fourthly, the retrieval probability for each item is calculated. So we have similarity, distinctiveness, retrieval, where T is a threshold, and that's noise parameter. Finally, we're going to get what I think is of interest to us is the probability that any given item is presented in the presented sequence will be recalled. Minimum sum of retrieval. Okay. So to get retrieval, we need distinctiveness and some threshold. To get distinctiveness, we need the similarity between item pairs, and then the similarity between item pairs is assessed by the logarithmic compression of memory at a given time point. Okay, so these stages are implemented in the graphical model. The graphical model corresponds to the observed times between learning and retrieval, T, and the observed number of correct responses for the ith item. So for the ith item in the jth condition, or the xth condition, excuse me, the available data are aggregated across subjects and the different word lists are completed by subjects, and so x sub n counts the total number of number of trials for each condition, which is the same for all words in that condition. Okay, so we're gonna get the number of trials in each of the conditions. We're going to get the items that were correctly identified for each of the conditions, because we're aggregated across subjects here. And then with that information, we're going to be able to get the probability of recalling a given item, as well as the probability of retrieval, the retrieval probability, which is determined by the threshold and noise parameters, in addition to the distinctiveness parameter, which is determined by the similarity parameter, as well as the, let's see, is distinctiveness. Well, C is distinctiveness. Discriminability, sorry. So C is distinctiveness. This is discriminability. Distinctiveness helps us calculate similarity. And we have items at a given time point, right? Okay, so time point for a given condition. Observed times between learning and retrieval. So here's the time of learning and retrieval, the success of the item for a given trial, the probability of it. Okay. We got it all in here. Let's take a look at some of these priors. Anything uniquely being modeled here? No, we got min. I don't think we've used logs before. Log t. Why log t ix? This is supposed to be equal to the model. Log t ix is the model, right? Yeah. Log t I, right, is equal to model 1. So we don't explicitly outline model, but each of these are a model. And we're assessing the difference between two models here, which are items, memory of items, whether you recalled an item. Let's see the graph. So why do we have two plates here? Well, in figure 145, times, responses, and probability apply per each item, right? So each item is going to get one of these parameters. However, similarity, discriminability, and retrieval apply the pairs of items. And so we have items within items here. So that's why we have the three subscripts. We have item I, J. So item, this could be the same value, right, for a given condition. So an item that is similar to itself. I'm just trying to get some verbiage, because imagine these loop over, maybe. Like, we just don't avoid items, but you can imagine this cancels out. Ah, that makes sense, right? So for examples where we're talking about the same item, we don't get a score here. But we're aggregated across subjects, right? Let's see. So we follow the Brown procedure. This means the entire graphical model is enclosed in a plate replicating over 6 conditions. So we were originally just talking about this, but we add this subscript X to all of them because we have multiple conditions we're looking over.
Excuse me.
conditions. I don't know what those conditions represent just yet, but we'll find out. Okay. I never know where to put the mic, but I'm trying to find a good spot for it that, you know, shows off this, even though the attention should be over here. Okay. Let's see. Good. Ed Hockery. Faced with a new phone. There is no room for ad hocery in Bayesian statistics. You get to your posterior, and that's what you're looking at. And you try to get to your representation of your posterior as accurately as possible. And if you did so, then there would be no room for ad hocery. I like that. Okay, so here's the simple script. The WINBA, the script's also going to produce an analysis of the posterior predictions and the joint parameter, posterior parameter space. Oh. Let's find it. Case studies. Simple. I'm looking at simple one. And JAGS. And set the working directory. Comment that out. First, just see if it runs. Compilation error on line 34. Index out of range, taking subset of length list. if I just do this. We're having some more issues. Let it begin. Okay, we're gonna go check out the stand model really quick. Looks like we're having some trouble. Doesn't look like I'm having some troubles here. It looks like something's out of script, and I just wanted to. So trying to get this process down in terms of how I can like best use my time on the streams. And if I don't get the initial compiling for the model, I try other approaches. I try to get the initial compiling before I go and dive into some of the code and stuff. So that's where we're at right now. Notes. For a spray of two possible lines to run, I suggest using the one with invert logic for better performance. Results are the same. Okay. And then we're just going to write some equal signs in here. Because we know Stan likes equal signs. Stan likes equal signs now. I must have forgot one. I did. Might catch a crash here.
But let's talk through
the Winbugs code, I guess. So we can just talk through code while the Stan code runs. And then we'll talk through the Stan code. Okay. So each of the data sets, 1 through 6, oh nice, we're running. So my predictive, those are bad, but I still was able to get out CTs, S's for all of the data sets. So that's fine.
Okay.
So the predictive checks didn't work, but I still was able to run it, which is a similar issue that was occurring with the JAGS thing data set as well. It's something about the current implementation of how we're doing predictive checks on the model. So that's something down the road we'd have to struggle with. So for looking at the Winbugs code then, for each data set, we're going to look at the length of the list, which is set by X. And here, let's see, X is here, I guess, list length for my data set. So in this case, 10. So the data set's 10 long. And then we're going to look at the first data set, or we're going to look at a data set for that particular. Item in the data set length, I'm going to do a binomial distribution with distributed with theta for that particular item. Wait, let me open the X data set. Oh, sorry, let me open Y. So you can see these are the 6 data sets across the top, the length, the counts of the data sets for each of the conditions. And it's this size, but some data sets are larger than others, right? So that's why this is only going to go up to the point where it meets the length of the data set. Okay, it's binomially distributed for that given. So we have a theta for I x, so first data set, this term, where n is also going to be equal to this count. Oh, sorry. N is going to be equal to n, but here is the total number of trials then. Well, the total number of trials, and then we're going to get the success rate, which is going to be here in our y. So we'll have these two values for this case, and then we have pretty y and predict PC. So we have predict y. A predictive check. So for the predictive check, we're just modeling here using the parameters with the binomial distribution. So we're not, this isn't the updated distribution. This is just the No, this is it. Yeah, so this is the predictive check for the new distribution. Right. So we take our new theta and counts, or we take the theta and counts, and we put in the pretty y, and then we're going to use we're going to get values for a predictive check here using pretty y over the, so we're going to get some value of y over the total amount. So we'll get a prediction for the successes. And we're going to look at the proportion of that. The correct recalls here. And this can be represented in the predict PC. But I might just scrap this in the code and see if it fixes some of the things that are breaking, even though it looks like no 10. This is, something's going on here.
Let's see.
Notice I was getting. All right. Now we're calculating similarities, discriminabilities, and response probabilities. So for each of the data sets, and then for the length of within the data set, and then we need to look at another item to do the pair. So for an item in the data set, and we're going to look at another item in the data set. So we're going to look at the similarity between item 1 and item 2 in a given data set. And we're going to calculate the temporal or the logged memory decay here. So we take our value of C for the given data set, which is C is known, it looks like. Nope, C is not known. C is distributed. Sorry, this is our likelihood. But this is the model. Okay, so C, which is distributed uniformly. Take the absolute value for given m. M here is going to be indicated by looks like we have M. And M looks like this. We calculated the temporal offset here, so we have D set, so data set, and then 1 to the number of words. We get the temporal offset for the given data set plus sequence each words times lag by negative lag 2 is here. Okay, so lag, so we have number of words, lag, and offset for each of the data sets. And we're going to calculate M for to give us our models for each of the data sets or for each of the items. So we're going to compare item models, memory decay models, across one another. Right. So here we are looking at item 1 for the first data set minus item 2 for the first data set logged. And this is going to give us our similarity. And then we're going to take similarity to get discriminability, where we use similarity here for the given item pair in a data set. And we take it over the sum of similarity for an item. So over the sum from whatever similarity we are with the item to the total length in that data set. In that data set, right? So this is just the sum of all the total similarities. So this is like a portion. Proportion of similarity. So how proportionally how similar is this similarity to the total similarity within a data set? And then we get the response probability here, which we look at the item pairs for a data set, and it's 1 over, and then it's just this calculated expression here where we're taking advantage of S, which once again is just uniformly distributed, and T, which is our, these are stochastic and these are like control parameters, right? Threshold and noise parameters. It's uniformative. And now with our response probabilities, we can parameterize data. So the probability of a given item's recall, which is the minimum 1 from the sum of the response probabilities for a given item to for each of the items in the list of a data set. And then we set price for all the data sets on informative. Posterior predictive analysis of the 6 data sets is shown here. So this is something we weren't able this is the reason why the code wasn't working. We weren't able to calculate these predictive posterior predictive checks.
Why?
Should we scroll back up, see if I can get some insight? This is a big error for Stan. following have undefined variables? So it looks like we had undefined variables for each. I see. Yeah, that makes sense because the data set didn't extend that far. So these are just dummy codes. So we weren't supposed to have variables for those. Divergent transitions. I see. No, so it doesn't look like we actually have a problem here. Because we weren't supposed to be able to calculate some of these predictive values for some data sets. So we should have only been able to calculate all the values up to 10, right? And then after that, some data sets just didn't have that many values. Okay. So I'm less convinced that this is broken, right? So we get these predictive values. And then we have the three constants. CTS for the items. So right, in this case, I guess all we really care about is the predictive. So let's take a look at these plots then. So posterior predictions of simple. Oh, well, maybe we can actually generate these too. Since we're not broken, right? Oh, heck yeah! Nice. See, this happens when we read. Okay. Oh, this trot. Predictions. So the probability of correct over the span of the experiment. And this is across 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these are 6 conditions here. Notice how we had less trials than we had more trials. Right, so that makes sense. And now the circles show the data, and the gray lines show the posterior predictive distributions. I see those lines. Yeah, we plotted a little different. So, right, the data here are demonstrated by the black dots. But we plotted the predictive checks just using, looks like a jitter. Might not even be a jitter. It's just how densely placed the points are for a given condition. And this kind of demonstrates why we were getting the dummy coding for the first data set with all the zeros. And we got the errors thrown at us in the command prompt. It's just because we're not calculating data for those. What do I think's happening here? This is moving forward in time, right? Item T. This demonstrates the effect that they were talking about, right? So what did they theorize? The simple model is supposed to state that model items that are farther away are less likely to be recalled, right? That's what the initial theory is, that distinctiveness plays a role in memory tasks, and that interference rather than decay is responsible for forgetting. But more temporally distant memories are more similar to one another. Okay. So we see temporally distant memories might be in theory, more similar to one another. No, that's not what this shows. Because the probability of remembering increases over time here. See, the probability of an item in serial position is recalled increases positions that are farther. So these U's demonstrate the, if I'm not mistaken, they demonstrate some sort of recency effect where people are likely to remember the first items they hear and the last items they hear, but not so much the middle items. That's what I'm seeing here. So here we have a third. All right, we have a joint parameter space for the simple model where we have the threshold for noise, and the distinctiveness of a given item. Let's see. I have to keep thinking about it. So this is the3D plot. That's interesting. Okay. Thank you. it looks like we only need a single discriminability and threshold function, and that's demonstrated here. Threshold. Ah, it seems unlikely that an alternative approach to fitting the six conditions using a single discriminability level and threshold function will be adequate. And we in part assume that because we can look at the distributions of the parameters jointly modeled here. Another intuition, this time coming from two-dimensional joint posterior, is the trade-off between threshold and threshold of noise. Since their joint distribution, shown by the solid black dots in the bottom of the plane, negative correlation. Ah, right, okay. I see the negative correlation between the thresholding parameters. Distinctiveness. Distinctiveness to me wasn't the parameter I predicted to be the most interesting. But if you look, I mean, we watch and predictives. But I'm interested in things like theta. Is there a way to get access to theta? Alright, so it definitely wants me to run more data, and in fact, the book in front of me. There's a way I can just get a GUI to show up and give me some insight without. It took long enough. So it wants me to modify so that the same parameter values are used across the data sets. Extremely sensitive to starting values. And it says that you need to modify the graphical model so that the parameter values are used to account for all data sets. Here is the Here is the code. Similarity, discriminability, response probabilities. We're more interested in the predictions that the model makes than any of the individual parameters of interest. For x sine. Some of the changes it talked about. Single discriminability level phrases. So here we have discriminability levels across data sets. So it wants me to say, okay, across instead of there being a for loop here for each data set, it wants me to say, scratch the for loop. And just give me that's not right. I don't need to scratch the for loop. I just need to make it so that similarity, discrepancy, and response, each of which are modeled just like this. I need to make it so that these three parameters are the same. Challenging. So what we would do is we would remove, just talk through what this might look like. Each of these parameters then gets distributed like that. And then we wouldn't need that. So now we're going to have CSTs equal across the data sets. And now we're still looking at item similarities, but now we've held those terms constant. I think I'd start there. Let's see what happens in the stand code when I do that. Parameters, this is in length equal to the number of data sets. However, we can change this think I even have to put that there. Right? Not sure if I have to put a 1 next to the vector. Oops. It's the last thing I'll check. And then I'll try to run it. this item's relationship with this item. The model for that one minus the model for that one. So comparing two items using the same constant. Let's see what happens. I just write dset here. Breaking here, this is exactly where I changed the C coefficient so that it was the same across. Maybe that's the issue where I don't need a set of C's anymore. I just need one C. Just change this to 14, this to 7.5, this to 0.6. Not really sure what I'm doing wrong in terms of sampling, but I know that there might be an example. Docs. Docs. Man, my file structure is really whacked. There it goes. But once I see it, I recall it. Hopefully I can find some insight somewhere. Lead me astray in these last examples. So, you know, you could make it so, in theory, what it's saying is we're making each of these parameters equal to constants, right? Instead of threshold noise and distinctiveness being variable, which they clearly are variable. But beyond that, I'm only taking in, those are the only initializations that I can change. Everything else is just hyperparameterized to be derived from other parameter, hyperparameterized such that it comes from the data, right? So these three group parameters I can specify as priors distributions, which I do set as being equivalent across each of the data sets, and I can't get the code to run. Though, and then everything else is determined from these values. So that's why my intuition tells me it's about changing those values, and everything else is just what I observed. So changing these values, holding them constant across data sets, would have some effect on all of the parameters we calculate that are of interest to the simple model. To the and simple being, it's called simple. Whoa, cool. So it looks like next time we're going to introduce a hierarchical structure to the simple model. That's really cool. So in order to, and then let's just briefly touch on what we're going to be extending the hierarchical structure to. It looks like it's going to be this threshold parameter. And part of that is because maybe it's not ideal that we have this relationship between threshold, high thresholds, and noise parameters. So if we model the threshold parameters such that we, it looks like we have this W indicator now. I'll be interested to see what that is. But now we're deriving the threshold parameter. It's controlled by these alphas and this W indicator. This discrete thing. Thresholds determined. Oh, is there another change to the model? Right, so these are just going to be the same instead of are held constant across conditions. Which is actually, let's take a look at how they did that right here. So they're just the same instead of being given values there. So, right, that would have involved changing that like we did. So we were on the right track. Sets and then we have T. Okay, and then all right. So it says the two changes. First, C and S are now assumed to be the same value across all conditions. And right, this is not realistic because, as we said, this figure 5.3 over here actually argues against that sort of relationship where it seems that these are quite distinctive from one another across conditions. But we're going to do so anyway, and then the threshold here will now be determined by the length of the item list for each condition. So now there's this additional conditional tune control negative 0 to 0, so all the models are supposed to be moving in this theoretically consistent way. List items as make the assumption that the linear relation expresses a decrease in threshold as item list length increases. So we model this bounded from negative 1 to 0, and it's going to be multiplied by some scale. It's going to be scaled by some length of the list, but it's always going to be moving in the negative direction. We're going to add that to A2, which is just going to be some constant. So like before, we have some constant. So this is, you could think of A2 as like the old T sub X, but now we're modeling the length, and we're going to scale. So we're going to add this. We're going to introduce change in the threshold as a function of the length of the list for a given condition. So that's what we'll focus on next time. Just wanted to talk through that. But overall, once again, as we get into these more complex examples, we're seeing a lot of cases where the example code is going to be breaking. We're going to have to be walking our way through it. In a lot of cases, I'm leaving my files all kind of broken up. So I'm definitely going to have to make a note to delete these files later. But that's where we're going to leave it off for tonight. Thank you guys for tuning in. And we'll start with the hierarchical example tomorrow and potentially move into an example close to heart to mine, the BART, which is a risky decision-making task, which I, for one, am a fan of. Well, not that particular task, but I'm a fan of risky decision-making paradigms. Anyhow, thanks, and we'll